the next portion of the talk, I'll move the slides with this, is going to be on chemotherapy and radioligand therapy. And you know, the focus is going to be on radioligand therapy, but obviously if there are questions after, we can I'm happy to expand. I wanted to give you some background for chemotherapy. And what I wanted to start by saying is that historically, actually, prostate cancer was felt to be relatively insensitive to chemotherapy. So there were a lot of trials in the 80s and the 90s that looked at a variety of different agents that were overall pretty disappointing. It wasn't until the development of taxanes, so it's a whole class of chemotherapies actually extracted from the yew tree, that we showed that we started to show that that chemotherapy could actually benefit our patients. And so the first of these was docetaxel or taxotere, which was approved by the FDA in 2004. After it showed a prolonged survival when it was compared to an older chemotherapy we'll sometimes still use, but mitoxantrone. And then 6 years later, cabazitaxel or Jetvana also received approval. And it was approved for mCRPC patients who had already received docetaxel, though I will say that both of these chemotherapies have been compared head-to-head in the front line or as a first chemotherapy for prostate cancer, have similar activity. They have different side effect profiles. But generally, based on this, for most patients, we'll start with docetaxel chemotherapy and then use cabazitaxel after because it has activity once the cancer has already been treated with docetaxel. Now, ever since these drugs have been approved, as you can expect, there's been a lot of interest in trying to improve their activity, the efficacy, by looking at a variety of combination treatments. Unfortunately, for the most part, these have been unsuccessful. But I did want to highlight this one study since this is a treatment that we bring up with our patient on a case-by-case basis. This was an academic study, so 160 patients out of MD Anderson that had mCRPC, and they looked at the combination of cabazitaxel but with the addition of carboplatin, which is another very common chemotherapy used in a variety of cancers. And what's important to highlight here is that this study was enriched for patients with what we call aggressive variant prostate cancer. And you know, there are set criteria that we'll look at for the purposes of a trial. But I think the bigger point is that these were patients with aggressive features. And so everyone got cabazitaxel, but half of the patients also had carboplatin added on to their treatment. And the study was positive in the sense that if you added carboplatin, there was a lower risk of progression and higher response rates compared to cabazitaxel alone. But as you can expect, it also came with more side effects, more toxicity. And if you looked at those 160 patients, the investigators couldn't show that there was a clear overall survival benefit to doing the combination. But interestingly, or importantly, when the investigators just looked at the subset of patients with aggressive features, then they did see evidence of a survival advantage. So this is not something that we'll recommend for everyone who's starting chemotherapy, but because of that study in patients who are, you know, fit enough to tolerate two chemotherapies and have aggressive features, then we will discuss adding carboplatin to either docetaxel, actually, or cabazitaxel. Then I'll shift gears now and talk about radioligand therapy. And as I was saying earlier, I'll put radium-223 azofigo to the side, but if there are questions afterwards, I'm happy to discuss this. But I'll focus on lutetium PSMA or Pluvicto. So what is a radioligand therapy? So as the name implies, it's a treatment that combines a radioactive isotope, an element like lutetium-177 that emits cancer-killing radiation, with a ligand, so something like PSMA-617, that can help direct your treatment into the cancer cells. And this is not unique to radioligand therapy, but the way that these drugs are designed lends itself very well to the ability of pairing them with a diagnostic agent. So once you have a target like PSMA, you can treat it with something like lutetium-177, but you can also use benign particles such as gallium PSMA-11, as we've talked about already, to image your patients. And you can use that for patient selection to make sure that the target of interest, in this case, PSMA, is expressed in the patient that you're seeing in front of you before considering treatment with lutetium PSMA. The VISION trial is the large international study that led to the approval of lutetium PSMA 617. And so these were patients with mCRPC that had received already a prior AR-targeted therapy and a chemotherapy. All the patients in that study were treated with standard of care, really supportive care measure. And that's one of the criticism against the study, was that the comparator arm, the control arm, did not include a lot of very active treatments. And then in the experimental arm, patients were treated with up to 6 cycles of lutetium PSMA-617 or Pluvicto. And the study was positive. So there was about a 60% reduction in the relative risk of progression with Pluvicto and almost 40% reduction in the risk of death. And so that, if you looked at the median overall survival, translated into an improvement from 11 months in the control arm to 15 months in the experimental arm. And so as a result of this, in March of 2022, the FDA approved Pluvicto. But again, this was in the post-chemotherapy setting. So patients had already received at least one prior taxane. Then I also wanted to talk about the therapy trial. So this was an academic study run out of Australia. So smaller study, but still very relevant, because what they did is a somewhat similar population than the patients enrolled in the VISION trial. But patients were randomized to either get lutetium PSMA or cabazitaxel, so a much more active control arm, and a smaller study also. So the primary endpoint of that study was to look at response rates, and it was significantly higher with lutetium PSMA relative to cabazitaxel. If you looked at overall survival, there were actually no significant differences. Now, part of it is that this was just 200 patients, so small differences could be there and just not picked up by that study. I think the other thing that it highlights is that cabazitaxel is still a very active and life-prolonging treatment in prostate cancer. But I think what this trial is, I think the even more interesting lesson that we learned from that trial is that if you look at side effects and quality of life, things like global health, insomnia, diarrhea, pain, fatigue, really all of these measures, all of these metrics favor lutetium PSMA. And so this is something that we often see very clearly in our patients who come to us, who've already had chemotherapy and then go on to receive lutetium PSMA, is that on average, it still has side effects, but it can be better tolerated than chemotherapy. I mentioned this a few times. We do look at PSMA PET scans before considering a patient for lutetium PSMA, and that's because you do want to make sure that the cancer expresses your target of interest. And the brighter someone's tumors are on a PSMA PET scan, the more likely they are. It's not the only factor, but it does predict better responses with lutetium PSMA. And fortunately, 90% or so of our patients with mCRPC, if we image them, we'll see that they have widespread expression of PSMA. But there are cases where we'll see a PSMA negative disease. So you can see here on the leftmost figure is a PSMA PET scan that shows PSMA have a disease. But this particular patient had an FDG, so a tagged sugar PET scan. And what you can see is that it actually shows areas of disease in the liver that are metabolically active but don't express PSMA. So this is an uncommon scenario, but this is a patient who would not benefit from Pluvicto and should instead go on to receive chemotherapy and probably first have a biopsy done to take a look at the biology of their cancer. I don't know if this slide or slide like this has been shown before, but this hints at what or gets at what Eric was talking about just now. So right now, lutetium PSMA, based on these two studies, is a treatment for patients who have already received chemotherapy. But obviously, the next question is, if it works well after chemotherapy, does it work just as well, perhaps even better, before chemotherapy? And so there are three studies that have all finished accrual, and so the results are starting to trickle in, looking at lutetium PSMA in patients who have not yet received chemotherapy. And I'll highlight just the PSMA-4 trial because those results were presented at a large meeting in the fall. So these were patients who were chemotherapy naive. The control arm was a switch in their AR-targeted therapy. So if they had progressed on abiraterone, then they would go on to get enzalutamide. And then the experimental arm was lutetium PSMA-617. And the study from the results, the preliminary results that were presented, was positive. There was a 60% almost reduction in the risk of progression with lutetium PSMA. And that actually translated into more than a doubling of the median time to progression. I will say right now, we need more follow-up to understand the effect on overall survival. And so that's something that we're still waiting for. And also results from these other two studies we had I'll go back just to show, we had participated actually in the ECLIPSE trial. And so waiting for those results to come in so we can understand exactly the role of lutetium PSMA in patients who have not yet had chemotherapy. I won't go into all of these trials, but what I wanted to highlight here is that the other area of interest is, well, what can we do to improve the activity of lutetium PSMA? And so there's a lot of studies that are ongoing right now. should either combine lutetium with radiosensitizing treatment like olaparib that could make the cells more susceptible to the effect of lutetium, combining it with immunotherapy to look for possible synergy between the two, and then other treatments that strategies to try to, for example, increase the uptake, the expression of PSMA on the surface of the cancer cells that theoretically could make lutetium more effective. So these are, just to summarize my points, so docetaxel and cabazitaxel, taxanes, are the only two chemotherapies to date that have established survival benefit in prostate cancer. But I will say that in selected patients, carboplatin has a role, and so we will recommend it. Radioligand therapy, so again, delivers a radioactive isotope to prostate cancer cells. And one of the really powerful aspects of this treatment is the ability to combine it with a diagnostic agent. So you can make sure that you're selecting the best patients for your treatment. And that approach sometimes is referred to as a theranostic, so combining therapeutics with diagnostics with the same target. And then lutetium PSMA 177 currently is approved for patients who have PSMA avid, so you do need a PSMA PET scan, disease that has progressed on an AR-targeted therapy and chemotherapy. But obviously a lot in the horizon about using it earlier and earlier in our patient's disease course. And then also looking at a variety of combination therapy to increase activity.